change frequently only if the time duration which we are considering is quite long. Suppose you are thinking about a particular day. So in a particular days there are many products for which prices will not change frequently. Now we cannot talk about every price that it will not change. There are certain things or there are certain assets for which price will change second to second, minute to minute, like stock market. But if you are talking about goods, basically you are talking about physical goods and services or capital stock as such. So in that case, you will find that prices will change only if we are considering long run. So in the short run, generally prices will remain fixed. And Keynes says that it remain fixed or it remains rigid more in the downward direction. It can go up, but going down from its previous level is not very easy. So major idea is short run. Major reason is short run behind that price rigidity, downward price rigidity. Yes, Sagar, I will be starting with classical dichotomy. So just wait for
ओके
few
मैम
seconds more.
मैम, व्हाट इज इफेक्टिव डिमांड?
We'll talk about it when we are talking about Keynes. Now there will be two concepts, aggregate demand and effective demand. So they are separate. How they are separate? Effective demand is a point of equilibrium, the point at which demand is becoming equal to supply, that will become effective demand. Demand can exist separately, and demand can be at any level, but only there will be one point where demand is equal to supply. So the point where demand is equal to supply, Keynes says that it is effective demand because this is the quantity for which people are willing to pay the price and suppliers are willing to supply at that price. Are you able to understand this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we'll discuss this more when we are moving further. Anything else?
मैम, वी हैव स्टडीड दैट गवर्नमेंट इंटरवेंशन इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, सो इट इज डायरेक्ट गवर्नमेंट इंटरवेंशन इज इम्पॉर्टेंट और इनडायरेक्ट वन?
Now, in the Keynesian system, the government exists in all ways, direct, indirect. What do you actually mean by direct and indirect? That is also very important. Let me understand from you. What is your idea when you say government intervention is direct or government intervention is indirect? Tell me.
Ma'am, according to me, if it is direct, so we will consider this as a fully fledged three sector economy.
Yes, very correct. So if you are saying government intervention is direct, it means that government itself is an economic agent. So the actual response or the reply which you should be giving for this is that government will act as an economic agent if the intervention is direct. If the intervention is indirect, that means government is there only to run the law and order situation, run the law and order system, maintain the security, internal and external security for the economy, running the administration, and doing some more activity. So indirectly, when government is involved, government will not take part in the production process. Government will not use much of the resources or factors of production in the economy. But when there is a direct intervention, government will invest, government will consume, government will save. That is meant by direct intervention. And maybe, see, I must have discussed the concept of invisible hand, which was given by Adam Smith, right? So when you are saying that government exists, we should understand that in contrast to this idea, classical system has this invisible hand. Now, can anyone tell me that what do you mean by invisible hand? Just one or two words, your answer should be.
It is market.
Yes. So market forces is invisible hand. It means forces of demand and supply. So Adam Smith believed that capitalist economy, and in the long run, demand and supply forces will determine all the decisions, or will guide all the decisions, and therefore there is no need for government. That's how they were talking about invisible hand. So this invisible hand is the forces of demand and supply, which will correct all types of disequilibrium. But Keynes says that no, government intervention is required to correct the disequilibrium. So invisible hand. This was by Adam Smith. Versus government intervention. And this idea was J.M. Keynes. And J.B. says law again is based on this idea of invisible hand, where when J.B. says that supply creates its own demand, it means that market forces are fully functional, and therefore there will be this invisible hand working, and that's how supply will create its own demand. Clear? Any doubt?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we'll move further, and we'll see, we are trying to understand the Keynesian system now. And I told you a few of the characteristics of the Keynesian system last time. So we are continuing that class, and we were at the point where we were trying to discuss that Keynes criticized the classical dichotomy. Now, let us see a diagram to understand this. Whenever, suppose you get a short note to write in the exam on classical dichotomy, so how you should be explained. You can use these two diagrams, and then you can explain the classical dichotomy. And remember, in economics, generally, the more we are explaining through diagrams, better it is. You have to write less, and you have to try to link everything which you write with a diagram. Now, you remember in the classical system, the aggregate supply curve was vertical. आई होप इट इज क्लियरली विजिबल टू एवरीवन।
यस
यस
मैम,
मैम।
यस मैम। सो दिस वॉज द क्लासिकल सिस्टम एंड यू रिमेंबर दैट द एग्रीगेट सप्लाई कर्व्स, हियर यू आर टेकिंग से वाई और आउटपुट, कैन टेक, यू कैन पुट एनी वेरिएबल हियर। Output and here you are taking general price level. General price level. So price level is in this direction, output is in this direction, and then this aggregate supply curve is vertical. Okay, so aggregate supply curve is vertical at the full employment level. Now if you change the level of aggregate demand, say AD1, you determine the price. Now this is P1. If you increase the level of aggregate demand from AD1 to AD2, what is happening? Can you see here? There is no change in supply. Only the change is in price. Supply curves remain as it is or the level of sub. हाँ बोलो
मैम, जो आप लिख रही हैं उसे थोड़ा मोटा करके लिखिए।
हाँ, that's what I was also trying to. So let me use another sheet and draw it again. Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we are trying to understand why Keynes was criticizing this classical dichotomy, or why Keynes used this term, classical dichotomy. Classical dichotomy is a term which was used by Keynes in to explain the equilibrium or to identify the shortcoming of the classical system. So in the classical system, you understand that at the full employment level, the aggregate supply curves become vertical or becomes vertical. And please see that the way you are stating, that should also be correct. What you are saying is that at the full employment level, aggregate supply curve becomes vertical. That is the right way, correct way to state this. Okay, here you are taking, and it is compulsory that you are writing general price level. You are not writing only price level, because when you will write only price level, it means you are talking about a micro unit or a market which is at the micro level. But here you are talking about aggregate economy. So for aggregate economy, price means general price level, right? Now if you change the demand, or with the demand, what you determine is only price. As you change the demand, as the demand goes up, AD2, price also goes up. So as the aggregate demand increases, it leads to change or increase in price. No change in AS or output. So you are able to explain through this diagram that in the classical system, real variable, that is the output. Output is the real variable. आउटपुट इज द रियल वेरिएबल सो द रियल वेरिएबल इज नॉट एट ऑल अफेक्टेड बाय चेंज इन द मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल व्हाट इज मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल हियर एग्रीगेट डिमांड इज अ मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल प्राइसेस आर डेफिनेटली अ मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल सो इफ यू चेंज दिस मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल देर इज नो चेंज इन द रियल वेरिएबल एंड दिस इज वॉट क्लासिकल डायकॉटमी इज दैट देर इज नो रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल्स एंड रियल वेरिएबल Why it is not there? Because the economy is already working at the full employment level. So supply cannot change, output cannot change. Now in the Keynesian system generally, the aggregate supply curve will look like this. Here again, general price level. And here again, output or income. On the x-axis. Okay. Now see if you change the demand, what is happening? As you change aggregate demand, as you change the level of aggregate demand from AD1 to AD2 to AD3, or you say from AD3 to AD1, what is changing is level of output. Y1, Y2, Y3. Price is not changing because price is fixed. So that's how the price rigidity you are talking about. Now in this case, if you increase the demand, it is not that price is increasing. Or if you decrease the aggregate demand, price is not decreasing. And that is what was downward rigidity, that prices generally don't fall. Prices can go up, but it can go up only after a certain limit. And what is that limit? If you are able to see this, understand properly, if the aggregate demand rises to 85, then the Keynesian system becomes similar to the classical system where rise in demand will only bring a change in price, not the output, because output will remain fixed at this full employment level. But Keynes is talking about before this level. According to Keynes, this YF level is not a reality because it is a short run. And in the short run, we are here. We cannot reach YF at any point of time. Now, is it okay? Are you able to understand this?
Yes, ma'am.
Anyone has any question or any doubt related to this? So in one sentence, what do you mean by classical dichotomy? Classical dichotomy?
No relation between.
Yes, no relation between real or monetary variables, or you can also say that when real and monetary variables
मैम केन्स क्लासिकल इकोनॉमी को क्यों क्रिटिसाइज कर रहे थे
आर इंडिपेंडेंट फ्रॉम ईच अदर और दे बिहेव इंडिपेंडेंटली फ्रॉम ईच अदर ओके सो देर इज नो इंटर रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन रियल एंड मॉनेटरी वेरिएबल्स दिस इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन दैट व्हाई Keynes is criticizing classical system. Anyone, any answer?
Because
why
of
Keynes
of
has to criticize?
Ma'am,
yes,
in 1920, street time, the classical economy is not
Yes.
able to.
Exactly. So because of the Great Depression, which existed in the Western economies during the 1920s and 1930s, the decade of 1920 and 1930s, basically 1929 is the time period which is identified with Great Depression. So during that depression time, that Great Depression time, classical theory failed to explain the situation. That is why Keynes is criticizing the classical system. I must have told you that Keynes was the student of David Ricardo. And initially, he also was a classical economist. When he was writing his treatise on money, he believed in classical assumptions. But when he saw during the late 1920s that the classical system, that automatic adjustment without time lag, employment depending on wage rate or flexibility of prices, when all these things were not happening, the economy was not able to come out of the depression. Because if there is no demand or if there is depression, what is the suggestion given by the classical system? Prices will go down. Now, prices will go down to what limit? Because the prices were becoming zero, they were becoming negative, but people were not purchasing. Why people were not purchasing? Because they were losing their jobs and they have already lost their jobs, so they don't have income. So if they don't have income or there is no demand, why there will be expenditure? So in that way, the classical system was not able to explain the situation, and therefore Keynes was trying to find out an answer for it. So it is not the only criticism. Criticism is to find out the solution for the depression situation for a particular economy. Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now let us move to another point of the Keynesian system. Remember few things. The moment you think about Keynes, immediately to your mind there should be few concepts which should come. When you are talking about Keynes, the first thing is short run. When you are talking about Keynes, when you are thinking about Keynes, the next thing which should come to your mind is price rigidity. The third is aggregate demand or importance of aggregate demand. Fourth is government intervention. Fifth is investment, role of investment or role of government expenditure. So these are the few things which should immediately come to your mind. Okay, now another idea with Keynes is less than full employment. So Keynesian theory starts with this, less than full employment. Keynes says that there is no full employment. Full employment is an ideal situation. Full employment is not a reality. Why full employment is not a reality? Because prices are not flexible, prices are rigid. So equilibrium, every equilibrium is always less than full employment, whether it is goods market, whether it is labor market, whether it is money market. Equilibrium is always less than full employment equilibrium. So we are not using the term YF, but only Y for Keynesian system. Now, less than full employment is due to price rigidity. When you say price rigidity, it is not only the rigidity in wages, but all the prices are rigid in the downward direction. Price rigidity is very important for Keynes. Whether it is general price level, whether it is wages, whether it is interest rate, or whether it is rent, or any price you think of. And this will all remain constant in the short run, rigid in the downward direction. They will not move in the downward direction. They can increase, but they will not decrease from their previous level. Why? Because automatic adjustment is not taking place in the economy. So why it is not taking place? And if it is not taking place, then how the employment will be determined? In the classical system, how we were determining the employment level? Do you remember that? Can you tell me? In the classical system, how you decide the level of employment? Or which factor will determine? I'm saying which factor will determine the level of employment?
Which private? Mem, full use of labor resources.
Okay, Nivedita, you are saying? Yes, Ankit.
Mem, wage price ratio.
What wage price ratio? No, it is not wage price. Don't call it wage price ratio. You should be calling it real wage and monetary wage. Use the words which the classical
okay.
system have used. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Yes, anyone else? What was the demand and supply of labor? No, Pankaj. How do you determine the level of
ma'am, level of output?
Yes, very correct. Yes, Shraddha?
Ma'am, fully utilized resources?
No, not fully utilized resources, not demand and supply, but it was only output. So, you remember this diagram? Output shown through production function. Q is a function of LK, T constant, and then you determine the level of employment. Okay, here N and here Y or O. So this is employment and this is output. So once you determine the level of output, employment automatically gets determined. In the diagram, in the lower part, you are talking about labor market equilibrium. Labor market equilibrium. Where you have demand and supply and then you talk about wage. Okay. So output and employment are interdependent. So employment depends on output. Now you remember this. Now let us see that what Keynes is saying. Keynes is saying that, please pay attention to this, level of employment depends on effective demand. It is not aggregate demand, but it is effective demand. Okay, the point at which demand and supply is equal in the market in the short run, or effective demand. The level of demand where buyers are willing to spend the amount which the suppliers are expecting. So this is the level of effective demand. Okay. This is important and this is different from what classical system was saying. Like suppose you have a demand for say laptop and Similarly, the whole class has demand for laptop, but maybe in a given point of time. We are not talking about long run. We are not talking about 5 years or 6 years, what is going to happen. But suppose we are only talking about this month. So maybe in this month, only 10 students from this section Z are going to purchase the laptop. So only 10 units of laptop are being sold in this month. And that is the effective demand. Maybe the whole class has a demand for laptop, but not everyone is purchasing in this month. Maybe they will plan that, okay, within 3 months, within 6 months, we will purchase it. Or there may be some people who have a demand, but they don't have the capacity to pay, or they are not willing to pay because of some other demand which is more urgent. So effective demand is that demand actually where expenditure is taking place. Okay, so you must try to understand the difference between actual buyers and prospective buyers. Now, how does Keynes explain the effective demand? According to Keynes, effective demand depends on aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. Now there are two more variables here. So you can see that actually there are three variables. One is effective demand, second is aggregate demand price, the third is aggregate supply price. So you have effective demand. Effective demand is a situation where aggregate demand price is equal to aggregate supply price. So effective demand depends on or is a function of aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. And employment is a function of effective demand. Employment is not the function of output. You remember? According to classical system, N is a function of output. But in the Keynesian system, employment is a function of effective demand. And effective demand depends on aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. Is it okay? Are you able to understand? Are you with me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now let us understand that how to show this. What diagram we are using to explain this aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. See, this is aggregate demand price. And this is the line which is aggregate supply price. Okay, here you take aggregate demand price, aggregate supply price, and here you take level of employment. एंड द पॉइंट वेयर दीज टू आर इक्वल टू ईच अदर दैट इज द पॉइंट ऑफ इफेक्टिव डिमांड एंड दैट डिसाइड्स द लेवल ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट विच इज N1 नॉट द फुल एम्प्लॉयमेंट. So as you increase the level of effective demand, that is aggregate demand price, ADP dash, effective demand goes up, ED dash, and level of employment goes up, N2. And you keep on increasing the aggregate demand price, and with a given aggregate supply price, effective demand will go up and level of employment will also increase. So in the short run, the equilibrium is always less than full employment equilibrium, because the level of employment in this less than full employment equilibrium is a function of aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. And the point where these two are equal is known as effective demand. So we have understood effective demand. Now let us understand aggregate demand price and aggregate supply price. Now see carefully. Aggregate demand price. What is the aggregate demand price? Aggregate demand price. Is the expected maximum price by the sellers or firms which they can achieve, which they can receive by selling the output, their output in the market. So the maximum price which they expect, who expects? Seller or firms? And aggregate firms, aggregate of firms. So all firms in the economy, all sellers in the economy, they expect the maximum price by selling their output in the market. So that is the aggregate demand price. That means the maximum which they can earn. So what is aggregate supply price? Aggregate supply price is that minimum price minimum price. This is the expected maximum price, minimum price which the sellers or firms should receive at least receive by selling the output to cover their cost of production. Now these are the two prices. the point where these two prices will meet, that will become the effective demand. Okay, so now understand this,
ma'am,
in the whole economy, in the aggregate economy. Yes. Tell me what you are saying.
मैं शो नहीं कर रहा था बोर्ड इसीलिए.
अच्छा, ओके. लेट मी शेयर इट अगेन.
मैम अब शो करने लगा जब आप लिख रही थी, उसमें नेटवर्क वीक होने के कारण शो नहीं कर रहा था.
ओके, इज इट ओके नाउ?
यस मैम.
यस मैम.
यस मैम.
ओके, सो नाउ रिमेंबर वन थिंग. In short, you should remember that aggregate demand price is the expected maximum price by the firms, and aggregate supply price is the minimum price. For the firms. So at least the minimum price means the price which is equal to the cost of production. So if the suppliers are at least getting the price which is equal to their cost of production by selling their output, they will employ particular factors of production. So whatever they are getting as price of their goods and services, on the basis of that price, they will employ certain factors, because at least the price is equal to the cost of production. And at the same time, there will be a price which they expect to get at the max when they are selling their output. So the point where these two prices become equal, that point is the effective demand. This effective demand. Why? Because purchasers, buyers are spending what the sellers are expecting. And this is very similar to what happens in the real market. You go to the market and you are thinking, you have planned to purchase something, right? And when you plan to purchase, you have a price in your mind, or you have a range of price in your mind. Similarly, seller also has a range of price in its mind. So when actually the purchasing is taking place, that means there is some common price where the buyer and the seller is arriving at. So that point will be the effective demand, but at the macro level. And that effective demand will decide the level of employment. But there is a specific nature of this aggregate demand and aggregate supply price. Now you see, aggregate demand price increases at a decreasing rate. But aggregate supply price rises at an increasing rate. Why? Because aggregate supply price is related to the cost of production. So as the level of output goes up, the cost of production also goes up. So it means that if the cost of production going up too fast, maybe there will be less employment created, or the number of laborers employed will be less if the cost of production is rising very fast. And at the same time, because aggregate demand price, the maximum price which they are expecting, increases at a decreasing rate. So with every increase in aggregate demand price, there will be less number of people which will be employed. Because the more the firm is selling, the less increase in price they can expect. And that's how your diagram looks like. So I hope you are able to understand this now.
यस मैम
यस मैम
एवरीवन नो डाउट आई गेस
नो मैम
नो मैम
नो मैम
नाउ डू यू हैव द आंसर फॉर व्हाई एडीपी इज इन्वर्टेड यू शेप देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन दैट कैन वी इंक्रीज द लेवल ऑफ इफेक्टिव डिमांड बाय इंक्रीजिंग एग्रीगेट सप्लाई ट्राई टू यूज द डायग्राम एंड अंडरस्टैंड दिस See what happens. Suppose your aggregate demand price is this and your aggregate supply price is this. So you increase the aggregate supply price. ASP dash, ASP double dash. So now the effective demand, it was here. And in this case, the effective demand is here. Okay. So yes, you can increase the level of employment from N1 to N2. But try to focus here. Comparatively, which factor appears more significant or more important in terms of increasing the level of employment? You can see that if you increase the aggregate demand price, you will observe a larger increase in level of employment as well as the price also. Now, this distance will actually affect wages. What is the possibility of rising wages with increase in the level of employment? Always remember that when you decide the level of employment, the next thing which you have to decide is the level of wages also. So if you try to increase the employment level through aggregate supply price, there is a small possibility of increasing the wages. But if you increase the level of employment through aggregate demand, you have a large possibility of increasing the wages. So that is how Keynes was emphasizing more on this aggregate demand price and effective demand. Effective demand can rise in both the situations. But see, aggregate effective demand is rising marginally when you are talking about aggregate supply price, ED2. But when you are talking about aggregate demand price, then see, effective demand is rising up to ED3. So the impact of aggregate demand price is much larger as compared to the aggregate supply price. I hope you are able to understand this. Now we'll finish the class here and we'll meet tomorrow. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
And tomorrow we'll talk about the consumption function, Keynesian consumption function.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Manasvi, ASP is related to cost of production. Now, if you try to remember your cost theory in microeconomics, you know that cost always rises at an increasing rate, because generally output rises at a decreasing rate. That's the law. That's the rule. Okay, thank you.
breaking, then it is also breaking. Break
thank you, sir. Sir, main sir bol sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
आज क्लास कब से चली थी यार? मुझे को लगा क्लास 9 बजे से.
9 बजे से थे.
यार मिस हो गई यार क्लास. कोई वीडियो लो भाई, अपलोड कर देना.
मैं तो तुम लोग के भरोसे था कि तुम लोग वीडियो बना के यूट्यूब में डालते हो.
भाई तुम तो क्लास किए हो ना आज. मैं इसकी बात कर रहा हूँ, आज क्लास में क्यों तुम रिकॉर्ड कैसे होगा?
मेमोरी नहीं है ना. आइडेंटिक मेमोरी होती तो दोबारा पढ़ने के साथ क्यों होती? दोबारा पढ़ने के लिए तो चाहिए रहती है वीडियो.
भाई तुम पढ़ते भी हो क्या? हम तो यहाँ पढ़ाई छोड़ दी है.
कितने बीघा जमीन है
मेरी? तो भाई इतनी है कि भाई पूछो मत.
बस सही है, कमाई नहीं है ना इसलिए पढ़ रहे हैं.
ये मोबाइल मेरा तुम ले लो, चलो कल तुम्हारे नाम कर देता हूँ.
नहीं बे, तुम डेयरी खोल ना, डेयरी खोलो ना.
नहीं बे, मैं श्रेय को अपना से सारी जमीन दे दूंगा. श्रेय भाई चलो कल आओ.
अरे नहीं
भाई, चल
भाई
नाम पे भाई ट्रांसफर कर देता हूँ. अपनी सारी प्रॉपर्टी तुम्हारे नाम ट्रांसफर. मैं जा रहा हूँ भाई, एक मठ है ना, हिमालय जा रहा हूँ तपस्या करने. उसके बाद बाल
खिलवा के. अभी मत जाओ, अभी अभी मौसम सही नहीं है. फालतू में पहाड़ आड़ गिर गया तो वहीं दफा.